On July 26, 1968, an SR-71 was flying over northern Vietnam when the Reconnaissance Systems Officer, or RSO, noticed an R light pop up on his panel, which meant that a North Vietnamese surface-to-air missile site was searching for the Blackbird on its radar. But the RSO wasn't worried. This was a frequent occurrence. Shortly after, he noticed an M-light illuminate, which meant that the Vietnamese radar was tracking them. That was uncommon, to say the least. But what happened next was arguably the longest minute of the crew's life. While the Blackbird was traveling at 83,000 feet at Mach 3 over Hanoi, the RSO noticed an L-light pop up on its electronic countermeasures panel. The L meant that one or more missiles had been fired at the aircraft. The atmosphere inside the cabin became critical once the pilot asked the RSO when the L light was illuminated and whether it had been a minute. The time was important because the flight time of the SA-2 surface-to-air missiles was only 58 seconds. Upon landing, the cameras later confirmed that two missiles had been fired. And that was the first time ever that a missile had been launched toward a Blackbird. Over the years, more than 4,000 missiles were fired at Blackbirds, but none of them ever hit the target. But why it took two Buicks to start the SR-71? How the Blackbird could take pictures that were not blurry, even though it flew at 3 times the speed of sound? What design feature capped the airplane's maximum speed? And why it was not fuel, but liquid nitrogen that restricted the combat range of the SR-71 is not what you think. Even though not a single Blackbird was ever shot down by the enemy, about a third of the SR-71 fleet was destroyed during freak accidents. Some people even came to believe that flying the Blackbird was basically a continuous series of emergency procedures. But the reality was the opposite. She was quite a reliable machine. Everything worked flawlessly in unison, pretty much all of the time. It's just that when things went wrong at Mach 3, it produced some memorable moments for the pilots. If there was something wrong during the flight, pilots felt it right away, since they knew every little flicker, rubble, or wriggle of the aircraft and what it meant. Nevertheless, if something went wrong, a master caution light would turn on. To know what was wrong, the pilot had to look at a panel that was between his legs. This panel had about 40 or so individual lights that pointed exactly to what was wrong. Here is one such story. On April 9, 1982, Colonel Lee Shelton and Major Bill Keller took off from Beale Air Force Base on an SR-71 airframe that was coming off from several years of deep storage. Everything went smoothly. Until, at Mach 3, at 71,000 feet, the master caution light came on. The pilots were surprised by it, because normally they'll be dealing with an emergency before the master caution light had come on. Looking at the panel of 40 lights, it indicated the System A flight hydraulic failure. Luckily, there were two independent hydraulic systems on the Blackbird, System A and B. But in case one failed, the procedure was to land as quickly as possible after dumping some fuel. As the pilot was descending, the master caution light came on again, indicating System B flight hydraulic failure. At this point, both crew went, "Oh shit!" because the emergency procedure for when both hydraulic systems fail is to immediately eject. But because they still had some control of the aircraft, they were able to continue flying and headed toward Beale Air Force Base to avoid ejecting. Once they reached 30 miles north of the airbase, they contacted the tower, letting them know that they had dual flight control hydraulic failure. The tower mirrored the crew's reaction. Oh shit! As the Blackbird crossed the runway threshold, the remaining pressure in System B hydraulic system was virtually zero, with the aircraft barely being controllable. Nevertheless, they landed safely. It turned out that the hydraulic seals in both A and B systems had failed, and out of the 6 gallons of hydraulic fuel, only a few cups were left in the system. But the crew wasn't always that lucky. When a similar incident happened on April 21, 1989, the crew of an SR-71 had to eject, because a hydraulic failure made the aircraft uncontrollable. The pilot and the RSO were successfully rescued near the Philippines, and the aircraft was later salvaged by the US Navy. But what was the SR-71 doing near the Philippines? There were two main operating detachments for the Blackbird, that one at Kadena Air Force Base in Okinawa, Japan, and that four at Mildenhall Royal Air Force Base in England. Usually, there would be three Blackbirds stationed at each of the detachments. The missions that were flown out of Japan were different from the missions flown out of England. In fact, the weather and flying missions for both detachments were on the opposite sides of the spectrum, since their geographies was very different. That one flew missions over North Korea, Vietnam, and eastern outskirts of the Soviet Union, while that four flew near the western areas of the Soviet Union, primarily in the area of Barents Sea, since their goal was to spy on the Soviet fleet of nuclear submarines. According to pilots, the most dangerous missions were the ones flown next to Murmansk submarine base, over the Barents Sea. The pilots feared that if something went wrong, say an engine problem, that it would have to go down to subsonic speeds, which made them an easy prey for Soviet MiGs. For this reason, all new crews were required to fly their first missions from Japan before they could fly any missions out of the UK. Of course, becoming a Blackbird pilot was incredibly difficult and competitive. On average, only two or three pilots were selected into the program each year. The physical requirements to join the program were believed to be on par with that of astronauts. But before flying any operational sorties, the pilots first had to fly a very special variant of the Blackbird for about 100 hours. The SR-71B was the training variant of the Blackbird and had a raised cockpit for an instructor, making it the fastest classroom in the sky. In its 30 years of service, only 150 aviators qualified to fly the SR-71, all of which were trained on one of the only two airframes of the SR-71B that were ever built. In fact, the SR-71B Blackbird with tail number 617956 was a record holder, having completed 1,454 flights and logged over 3,900 flight hours, more than any other SR-71 in history. But what if I told you that you could own a piece of that historic airplane? This is Habu. Not only does its crown resemble the SR-71's dual-engine inlet cones, this limited edition timepiece incorporates actual materials from the SR-71B with tail number 617956. The lower dial is fashioned from the aircraft's inner engine nacelle exhaust ejectors, while the top dial draws inspiration from the Blackbird's exhaust flaps. The face of the watch echoes the Blackbird's cockpit gauges. The power reserve indicator mimics the triethyl borane throttle system that the Blackbird needed for ignition at high speeds. Brushed hour and minute hands reflect the aircraft's silhouette from above. And the FKM double injection rubber straps mirrors the red nose step zones from the Blackbird's fuselage. Habu has a commanding presence, yet remains lightweight and exceptionally comfortable on the wrist. So use the code NWYT to pre-order your limited edition watch using the link in the description. This masterpiece is more than just a watch. It's a story waiting to be told. Out of the 29 SR-71A variants, only 10 airframes were in active service. The other 19 aircraft were in maintenance, as Lockheed engineers took the aircraft apart and put it back together, or placed them in deep storage. But why did they keep some aircraft in storage? Well, it was to make sure that all airframes aged at the same time, which is why all the aircraft were periodically rotated in and out of storage. This worked out pretty well, and by the time the Blackbirds were retired, the average airframe had accumulated 2,300 hours, with only a few hundred hours separating the high and low time birds. One of the most exhilarating things you could do with the SR-71 was to fly it across the Terminator, the division line between day and night. When you fly higher at an altitude of 80,000 feet, the Terminator is even more pronounced than at sea level. The Blackbird pilots would compare heading toward the Terminator from the light to flying into a black wall. During one winter mission over the Arctic Ocean, due to its high speed, an SR-71 managed to cross the Terminator six times in 1 hour. meaning that the crew experienced 3 sunsets and 3 sunrises in just 60 minutes. And sometimes they would have 2 breakfasts in a day. See, each pilot's tour lasted about 6 weeks, which happened 4 to 6 times per year. This meant that the SR-71 pilots had to endure the ultra-boring, most uncomfortable commute known to mankind from Beale Air Force Base to one of their detachments at the back of a KC-135Q tanker. Depending on where the mission took place, the pilot's commute was somewhere between 12 to 24 hours. The alternative was a glowing heat mission, which involved flying an SR-71 at Mach 3 to its area of deployment. Glowing heat missions would happen once an SR-71 had undergone scheduled maintenance and needed to be returned to its assigned detachment. Everyone, of course, favored the glowing heat sorties. Not only was it faster, but also the pilots would eat breakfast at Beale Air Force Base, then light the burners and after 7 hours, eat breakfast again at Kadena Air Force Base in Japan. You could say the SR-71 was a high-maintenance bird. Each time, it took about 18 to 20 hours to make the aircraft ready for the crew. This included avionics specialists uploading mission information into the aircraft. It took a crew of 16 a few hours to inspect every area of the airplane prior to each flight. Then 4 people would spend an hour to fuel the aircraft. The air crew arrived at the hangar 40 minutes before the scheduled takeoff time. Prior to each flight, the spikes were tested to ensure they would extend and retract within 1/10 of an inch of each other. This was important to ensure that supersonic shockwaves would form equally on both sides of the aircraft. Otherwise, it would have caused an aerodynamic disturbance. Each spike was responsible for holding a shockwave in place by moving horizontally up to 26 inches. That's because at 80,000 feet, the air is too thin, and the faster you go, the more air and fuel the engines require. And retracting the spikes at higher speeds allowed more air in. The movement of the spikes also kept the shockwaves from being engulfed by the inlets, because if a shockwave entered the inlets, it would have hit the first rows of compressor blades with such force that it would have instantly destroyed the engines. Speaking of engines, the Blackbird's J-58 engines did not have a starter. So an AG-330 start truck, nicknamed Buick, was used to start the engine. Originally, inside a start cart, there were 2 Buick V8 engines mounted in tandem with automatic transmission that had a vertical drive shaft which was inserted inside the Blackbird's engine. Each engine required 1 Buick cart to start, and it was incredibly loud since the engines had no mufflers. The limiting factor in flying the SR-71 at Mach 3 was not the amount of fuel, but the amount of liquid nitrogen which was required. See, as the fuel was consumed, fuel vapors would fill the top of the tank, which could ignite, since during Mach 3 flights, the fuel tank heated up to 300 degrees Fahrenheit. For example, on July 17, 1996, a TWA Boeing 747 exploded 13 minutes after taking off from New York due to fuel vapor ignition inside the center fuel tank. Therefore, to prevent the Blackbird from exploding, the solution was to purge fuel vapors and replace them with inert nitrogen gas. A heater would convert the liquid nitrogen into gas, which then circulated throughout the fuel system. But during aerial refueling, the nitrogen was vented out of the fuel tanks whenever the tank's pressure exceeded 6 psi. The thing is, there were only 2 27.5-gallon liquid nitrogen tanks on the Blackbird, so the airplane's range was limited by the amount of liquid nitrogen inside the tanks. Later on, a 13-gallon additional tank was installed to extend the range of the aircraft. It's true that the SR-71 Blackbird leaked fuel, and it's also true that the aircraft would always perform aerial refueling shortly after takeoff. But it's a myth that the aerial refueling was due to the amount of fuel leak. The Blackbirds refueled shortly after takeoff for 2 main reasons. The first was due to weight. When the aircraft was fully loaded with 80,000 pounds of fuel, It could damage the landing gears during taxiing and takeoff. This was learned the hard way. So they instead took off with about half a tank and refueled once airborne. The second reason was for practice, because besides the 29 operational SR-71As, there were also 35 KC-135Q tankers that needed to practice mating with the Blackbird. The SR-71 was a spy plane, so it was equipped with a state-of-the-art camera for its time. From 85,000 feet, this camera was able to take a picture of a 6-inch object from 85,000 feet. But before the camera could snap a photo, there were two big problems that needed to be resolved. The first issue was air conditioning for the camera when the airplane flew at its maximum speed, and heating for the camera when the spy plane traveled at subsonic speeds, say during aerial refueling. But a much bigger problem was the Blackbird's speed. At cruising speed, the SR-71 would move 3,000 feet per second. This meant that if the camera took a picture with a shutter speed of 1 millisecond, the aircraft would have traveled 3 feet during exposure. But in reality, the exposure time was much slower. The aircraft would move about 742 feet during slow-mode exposure and 371 feet during fast exposure settings, and this would result in blurry images that were unusable. The solution was a gimbaled mirror, which moved precisely to compensate for the SR-71's forward speed. But how fast did the Blackbird exactly go? The official unclassified answer was that the SR-71 was capable of Mach 3+. The aircraft was designed for Mach 3.2, however, its normal operating speed was Mach 3.17. With regards to the maximum altitude, officially it was 85,000 feet, with some sources saying that the Blackbird was capable of flying at 100,000 feet and even higher. The reality was that the aircraft could fly faster and higher, but its speed was limited by the compressor inlet temperature, which maxed out at 800 degrees Fahrenheit. This meant that depending on the outside ambient temperature, the Blackbird sometimes flew slower or faster. But in case of emergency, the crew of SR-71 were allowed to use tactical limits, in other words, pushing the aircraft to its maximum speed. The alternative of being shot down by a missile outweighed all the negatives of maxing out the aircraft. This meant that the inlet temperature could reach 842 degrees Fahrenheit for up to 1 hour at a time, but they were never allowed to exceed Mach 3.3. Interestingly, during the record-breaking flight across the United States from coast to coast, the crew originally asked if they could fly at Mach 3.5, which would have meant a coast-to-coast flight in under 60 minutes. But Lockheed said it was a bad idea, because if engine on-start occurred at speeds above Mach 3.3, the crew may not have been able to keep the pointy end forward. So they ended up doing the record-breaking coast-to-coast flight at Mach 3.3, which took them 67 minutes and 54 seconds. There is only one documented occasion where a Blackbird pilot claimed to hit Mach 3.49 because the temperature of the inlet was far below the 800 degrees Fahrenheit threshold due to a cold snap near Murmansk. But the theoretical maximum speed of the Blackbird was Mach 3.55, because at that speed, the spikes would have been fully retracted and lost their ability to interact with the shockwaves.